I turned around to get back in, and he locked the door.
So he really is more intelligent than we give him credit for.
Oh, yes. Sometimes.
Well, how long have you been doing this? I mean,
this show, 4 or 5 months now, maybe.
Okay. How are your Nielsen ratings?
I don't know.
One. He's got one.
You're getting
get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, columnist and reporter for the News-Sentinel. With me today is John Olinger, former member of the Fort Wayne Community School Board, and John Pierce, a current Fort Wayne School Board member. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah, the main topic today will be the $119 million building improvement referendum on the May 8th ballot, mm-hmm. which the voters will have an opportunity to approve or reject. So I thought it would be timely to discuss the pros and cons of that, what the proposal is, and what the ultimate benefit and goal is. Before we do that, why don't we talk just real briefly about the academic performance of the Fort Wayne schools, which I think will lay the framework for talking about the need for the buildings, because bottom line, as I think you both agree, it's all about education ultimately.
Absolutely.
So, John Pierce, this is going to be confusing with two Johns.
John 1 and John 2.
John Pierce, why don't you talk a little bit about the annual yearly performance ratings under No Child Left Behind, which now for 2 years, I think, running, mm-hmm. you have shown improvement, kind of reversing a long trend. So talk a little bit about how you did that and what it means.
Okay, great. The annual yearly progress is a measure under the No Child Left Behind, as you say. And it's quite unusual for a diverse urban school district to do well there, because our district has to meet all 37 cells, which is we have a very complex school district. Our students speak over 80 languages. We're close to 70% free and reduced price lunch. And for the last 2 years, we have achieved annual yearly progress. We're not satisfied with where we are, because we know we have to continue to improve, but that is a mark of continued and significant progress year over year.
So do both of you think, the people the last time around, who made the argument that, well, I'm not gonna give the schools any more money until they mm-hmm. actually demonstrate their teaching kids, is that argument to some degree anyway off the table, do you think, John?
I think it was a bad argument last time. We have buildings, they're assets in terms of the net worth of the community. Whether they're schools in them, whether they are a city building, a county building, you still have to maintain them. And although I was opposed to the last round largely because of the amount, I think to equate, there's no connection between academic and buildings. I can take it to the best building, but if you don't have good curriculum, if you don't have good teachers, you're not going to have the best test scores, you're not going to have the best education. In the same respect, when you go, one of the best teachers I've ever seen at Snyder, Francis Mustafa, mm-hmm. Just pulled up stakes. He retired, took all his retirement, and started building a school in Sierra Leone, Africa. And when you see their building, he came to our house the other night and showed us the pictures of his building. It's a concrete building. He's raised $150,000 to build two huge school buildings. $150,000 doesn't buy a portico on one of our buildings, and they're able to educate hundreds of kids in basically a concrete shell. So, you know, it's about the education to me in terms of academic performance, and I don't know that they're connected directly.
Well, not directly, but I would argue that having confidence in the academic performance of the school can't help but give you more confidence in their ability to improve the buildings wisely and in a cost-effective way, John.
And I would agree, and we all agree that academic performance is the number one topic. And, you know, I think in our system and in our economy, I think the condition of the buildings is important and can contribute to success, just as, you know, a manufacturing plant that is well-lighted and well air-conditioned or well-heated can help improve the productivity of the people that are in it. That's part of it. But as John said, it is a measure of our assets in the community.
Right.
And it has a tremendous impact, potential impact at least, on the home values, stability of neighborhoods. And
right.
so the whole community stands to benefit if schools are well run and well maintained.
Well, let's move on now to the referendum proposal itself. As I mentioned, $119 million. Okay. Projection is, I think, for a home valued at roughly $89,000, an additional $27 per year in property taxes.
Mm-hmm.
Not a lot to some people, probably mm-hmm. could be felt by other people.
Mm-hmm.
John Pierce, explain a little bit about what that money would buy.
Okay, it is primarily school infrastructure, and by that I mean roof repairs. We've got a budget to take care of roofs, but Many of these buildings were built in the 60s and 70s for the baby boom generation, so they're in need of repair all at once.
Yeah, the average age is, what, about 54 years?
54 years, yeah. Last time we built a new school was in 1976, mm-hmm. so it was quite a long time ago. But it's heating and ventilating, air conditioning systems, it's cracked masonry, it's inefficient windows. We've got construction that was done cheaply and quickly during the baby boom years. With things like what we call curtain walls, which have R ratings as low as R3. So the energy efficiency of our buildings, which we're burning taxpayer money when we're not doing them efficiently, but creating conditions where, you know, we don't have extreme temperatures inside. We also have some safety concerns. For example, at Harrison Hill, we had a boy fall through an open railing and broke his arm last year. We've got some concerns about handicapped access, because many of these buildings were built before we had codes and concerns about that. So it's a wide range of factors, but most of it are things that a person would not see by walking in the building. It's in the basement, it's behind the walls, it's on top of the roof.
Now, John, you were on the board, as you mentioned, was it 07 when they proposed the $500 million referendum?
Right.
You mentioned you opposed it at that point. Talk a little bit about why you did that and how, if in your mind these are different, other than the obvious
They are different.
Talk a little about what you think of the current proposal.
The current proposal, as John said, is largely infrastructure. It doesn't contain the wish list of things that I think the first bond did. It doesn't have a lot of fluff in it. It is about roofs, it's about windows, it's about the things that really, I mean, John hit it on the head. Yeah, one thing I hate to hear is the average age of the buildings is 54 years. When we're done with this, when we spend $300 million, if we were to spend $300 million on the buildings, the average age of the buildings is still 54 years.
Well, and I should mention that the city just spent $14 million to move into a 50-year-old building downtown.
Right, so. Exactly. Yeah. But what you have to keep in mind, it's not the age of the building that's relevant. It's the effective age of the building. In other words, the condition. When we have a house, the roof starts to go bad after 20 years, you put a new roof on it. We have 20-year roof replacements plans in the school system. The problem is, due to the economy, we've had to make cuts here and cuts here, and we've got behind on schedules and things like that, and it's got to the point where we need infrastructure fixed. We needed this work done 3 years ago, and I probably would have gladly supported 120, 130, even 150 million is what I actually thought was the amount of work we needed done in 07. But it comes down to improving the effective age of the property, and keep it in a condition where it's safe, it's energy efficient. You do, you know, unfortunately, we don't live in a world where if we're going to work on a school, you can't do ADA. Mm-hmm. When you tear into the building, you have to make it ADA compliant.
Americans with Disabilities Act, for those who don't know the acronym. Mm-hmm.
So you will have naturally higher construction costs in a school project because you are bringing it up to a current code that didn't exist when it was built 20 years ago, 40 years ago, 50 years ago.
Okay. Yeah. John Pierce, talk a little bit about the strategy you intend to follow in trying to get this through. You've outlined some of it, but obviously there's going to be a cost, there's going to be a campaign.
Yes.
To get the voters, especially in a tough economy, to agree to pay more.
Yeah.
What's your game plan?
Yeah, we do have to run it as it is a campaign. And what we've been doing as much as possible is to speaking to groups, for example, neighborhood association, chambers of commerce, retirement communities, and others, so that they understand what they get for their increase in property taxes. Because the ballot question itself is not going to explain much of that. They need to know before they go into the ballot box what this is about, what the benefits are. We are also going to conduct a campaign, as you might for any other candidate, with some direct mail to encourage voters to remember to vote for the ballot and vote yes for the ballot question. We're going to do a little bit to get voters who might not necessarily vote in a primary, but, you know, stand to benefit more directly to make sure that they do go to the polls and vote.
Now, there will be a cost involved in that. Do you have a budget? And I understand that the schools will not be underwriting it, correct?
Correct, yeah. We've formed a political action committee called Repair FWCS, and we are raising funds, donor funds. And our ability to communicate and raise funds is severely restricted, and with some good reason. For example, we're not allowed to use any school resources, even email, to communicate. certain vendors who already have contracts with us or those who stand to benefit if it goes through are limited on what they can do to contribute. So we're relying on the general public basically to back this campaign. And you know, you're right. It's, if you think about, well, what are going to be the draws in this primary? Looks like we'll have a still contested presidential race.
Well, yeah, at least on the Republican side.
Yeah. But,
and then the local races, which aren't, frankly, all that exciting.
Right. And then, so, you know, Murdoch and Luger.
Yeah, Murdoch, Luger.
Those will be the draws.
Yeah, the Luger-Murdoch thing should be.
That's probably going to be the hot one. I don't know that, it, I mean, I think it's an uphill battle. You know, it is. He is right to treat it as a political campaign because that's what it is. Oversimplification, you're going to have to ask a bunch of largely Republican voters to vote to tax themselves. Mm-hmm. And that is always
swimming upstream, especially this
election.
Swimming
upstream. Yeah. Yeah. Because really, you look at it, the President Obama is not opposed. I don't think there may be opposition in the Democratic governor's race. I don't think there is.
Yeah.
When Moses is unopposed, the Democrat incumbents are largely unopposed. There's not a lot of reason for Democrats to go to the primary, and not that I'm being.
You don't think county council is going to bring them out?
No. those are the races. It's like school board. Those are the buttons you push to get out of the voting booth and go home.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, the reason people are going to show up on the Republican side is we're going to have a contested primary. We have a hotly contested Senate race, and both candidates will be in Fort Wayne within a week of the election. And I think you have, I'm trying to think of whether Republican, I don't know, there's a lot of other Republican races that are contentious. Yeah. Those are the two main ones, but it doesn't get bigger than the presidential race. So I think you'll see large Republican turnout. I don't know that you're going to see as much Democrat turnout. So, you know, the area that you have to win strategically is largely St. Joe Township and the north side of Fort Wayne.
Well, and I could infer from that then one thing the schools need to do is make sure the Democrats come out, perhaps.
Yeah, and that's pretty hard for a nonpartisan ballot question
to encourage
Democrats to come out.
But you can target them with mailing.
Sure,
and,
exactly. And the other thing to think about is that, what was I going to say? Well, it is largely a tax issue. That one thing that people need to understand is they do not have to declare Republican or Democrat
right.
to vote on the ballot question.
Right.
They can ask for what's called the question ballot, and the only thing on that ballot, if you live in the Fort Wayne Community Schools district, is
the question. And believe it, even on the regular ballot, it's the first thing on the ballot.
For the first
it?
Time,
yeah.
The question will be the top thing on the ballot.
I should mention before we go any further, this is being billed, I believe, as phase one
yes.
of perhaps a two or three phase project, which could have another $133 million.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm assuming this goes through,
mm-hmm.
If not, then maybe it's a moot point. But
yeah.
There is no organized opposition yet, as far as I'm aware. Correct?
I'm not aware of any either. The opposition is apathy, I think, in this case.
You're right.
The one complaint I have heard from some of the people who are involved in the Code Blue opposition the last time around is, well, you're spending a lot of money on air conditioning, for example.
Yeah.
I'd like to get maybe both of your takes on that. Is it true? Is it a justified complaint? Or is the way our school year today, air conditioning, gone from a luxury to a necessity, do you think?
Yeah. About 10% of the budget for this plan has to do with air conditioning. And 8% of that would be new air conditioning. We're in schools that don't have it now. 2% would be replacing air conditioning that already exists there. And we, for example, when we did the project at Franke Park a few years ago, which was one of the last, what we might call a major project, they had temperature ranges in their school from 50 degrees on certain days of the year to actually 100 degrees on other days. And if you think about, we only have 180 days to teach kids, and the time that we spend in the classroom is vitally important, and you have to manage classroom behavior with kids, all that stuff, and the productivity of our employees while they're in class. We think it's important. We think that, you know, if you go to any other place of business, that they're in an office-type condition or interior condition, whether it's manufacturing or office, you have people who argue whether it's 71 or 74 degrees. And And we've got much more extreme conditions than that. So I do think that it is important. We also have health concerns. The amount of kids with asthma is increased in humidity, temperature, those kind of things can have an impact. And a lot of air conditioning is about taking moisture out of the air. And when you've got leaky roofs and things like that on top of it, you know, moisture is germ-providing atmosphere, and we don't like that.
John?
10 years ago, we looked at air conditioning all the buildings. It was about an $80 million price tag. And the board turned it down. And when the current superintendent took over, she looked at it again, and it was maybe $100 million by then. And then at that point, it wasn't long after that that there was the $500 million on the board or on the table. What isn't really public is what we talked about, $80 million, this was 10 years ago, was air conditioning all schools. It was about half that if we did it as we open the buildings and renovate them. Which is what we're doing now.
Yeah.
It makes no sense to air condition our buildings and have a construction project where we're just air conditioning but it equally makes no sense to open up a building, have the walls open, be able to add the ductwork relatively cheaply, and not air condition a building. When I was in school 6 or 7 years ago, I went from Labor Day to Memorial Day, you know. Now we can't, we have to have make-up snow days. We're going from mid-June to mid-August, about another 30 days in the hottest time of the year, especially August. Mm-hmm. August is the hottest month of the year. John's right in terms of when we're sitting in a classroom that's 95 to 100 degrees, less gets done. Less got done in my day, except we had 4 or 5 days a year we had to deal with it. Now they're looking at 2 or 3 weeks. And in those weeks in between, the buildings are still being used. We try and get, I shouldn't say weeks, I'm not on the board anymore, but we try and get the most use out of public buildings as possible. That means community mm-hmm. groups, that means PTA, that means mm-hmm. Churches are renting the buildings and paying us for the rent. But summer school programs, remediation programs, those buildings, a lot of buildings are being used 12 months a year. So it's one thing to say we're going to air condition our buildings. I would still oppose that. I think it would be a waste of money because there's a cheaper way to do it. And the cheaper way to do it is do it when the building's open and being renovated, and you can do it for about a half to a third of the cost of adding air conditioning on its own.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask this, and I think it's a legitimate question up to a point anyway. The schools have a capital budget mm-hmm. every year.
Mm-hmm.
In theory, enough to pay for routine maintenance. Yeah. A lot of this, at least at one point, was routine that because of whatever has grown to be not routine.
Mm-hmm.
How would, John Pierce, you answer that question? You know, you have a repair budget. Have you used it adequately or properly?
Right. And I would go with Yogi Berra's famous quote, in theory and practice are the same, in practice they're not. And in practice, what's happened is our capital project fund has been deteriorated over the years for a number of reasons. Number one, our tax base has declined. Property tax, the circuit breaker, those caps have
1%
cut.
1% cap.
Yeah, have cut $2 million out of our budget mm-hmm. every year. And we've had a law passed by the state where we had to fund teacher pensions differently. And the school board that was faced with that, because it had to be tax neutral, I mean, we couldn't raise other taxes, they had to cut it from somewhere. They chose not to cut it from classrooms. They chose to take it from this budget. And a lot of those decisions were made at a time when our buildings were not in the conditions that they are now.
Right.
So they were probably wise decisions at the time. But for example, this coming year, we only have about $4 million to devote to this kind of projects. You know, that fund, some people will point to, well, you're taking utilities insurance out of there, but that was something mandated by the state. It wasn't taken out of the budget. It was added in as an addendum to that budget, and we can't use that money for anything else but.
And if you didn't use it, you'd have lost it.
Yeah, exactly. So
what about, though, the comment that you're also taking, I think, a little over $6 million out of the capital fund to fund quote-unquote racial balance, which uh-huh. is a little bit of a misnomer anymore, but do we still need to do that, or could that money be better spent for capital?
That money is spent, almost all of it, for teachers. I think it funds something like 62 teachers and building coaches. And these are like teachers in some of our preschools. They are coaches that coach other teachers, and they are also resource type teachers in the magnet type school programs. And this is something that was a result of a lawsuit. I mean, this is something we have to do.
Well, you had to do it. I don't think you have to anymore, correct?
No, we still do. Yeah, the lawsuit's still in place. We still have to.
John's shaking his head.
No, the law school, it expired. It doesn't. I believe now I say that. They can't just arbitrarily say we're not doing it anymore. You have to go back to the state and have the legislature change the fund. So it's not something that Wendy and the board can wake up tomorrow and say, we're not doing it anymore. But I think, you know, it to me, looking at it, there's two things that concern me. I think a lot of the programs that were funded aren't there anymore. You know, St. Joe Central used to be a math choice school. It's not. They're not funding the extra math credits, the teacher doing the math instruction. There's a lot of little things like that. I think it's become a fund to fund projects, which the board and the superintendent think are positive programs, and many of them are. One thing I think we could do better is, because that's taking $8 million roughly a year out of capital projects. Southwest Allen County accomplishes some of the same thing, but instead of having a referendum on hundreds of millions of dollars, they asked for an increase in their general fund of $8 million to fund teachers.
Above the levy.
Above the levy. That's also above the circuit breaker. We could do the same thing, and I think it'd have a better, you're still going to have the same argument because you're still asking a bunch of homeowners and in a bad economy to tax themselves, but it's a easier pill to swallow to say, please raise our general fund $8 to $10 million rather than 150, and then you move the racial balance fund over to the general fund,
right.
Free up $8 million a year for capital projects, and you solve what's causing or help to solve what's causing the problem. The problem is the bonding itself isn't going to solve the problem that we still won't have enough money in our capital projects fund. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's something we're going to have to come to grips with at some point in the future.
If we look at the matter at hand and the urgency at hand, one of the things that doing this $119 million of project repairs will free up more of the money that we do have because it will catch up.
Cost.
It'll catch us up with some of our roof, John mentioned, our roof maintenance plans and things like that. So we will have money for emergency repairs or ongoing projects. So there will be some relief there in that regard.
Well, let me ask you this, John Pierce. What happens if the voters, despite all your efforts, say no?
Yeah. When this first came before the board, I asked, going back to something we said earlier, how tough this will be during the primary. A lot of people have said, well, why don't you do it in November? And I posed that question, and our maintenance and facilities people said, we can't wait. Snyder High School in particular cannot wait. I mean, conditions are such that would put it out a whole nother year. And so we are very concerned if this does not get through this time. There are some provisions that if an emergency were to occur, like pipes leak at Snyder and there's a great deal of flooding, that we can go without going to the public, but appeal and get some emergency money. But paying, it's like going to the emergency room. You're going to pay more money. It's going to be short term. You're going to disrupt school. Under this project, we'll be able to manage how the project is done, like especially for someplace like Snyder, which is going to be a massive project, and do it in a way to have least disruption in the classroom. And that's what this is all about. It's helping our classrooms run more smoothly in better learning environment. So the other option is to just wait a certain period of time or totally change it and offer something totally new again to the voters.
How much do you have in your cash reserve right now? You know?
I don't know right hand, offhand. What we try to do is to keep at least a week's worth of expenses in cash reserve, and I think it's fluctuated between 1 and 2 weeks.
Okay, but you're not so flush like the city and county are that you could do a capital project you've got.
The thing with the cash reserves, it's a misnomer. It's not always there. Mm-hmm. It's a kind of average fund because as we're only paid in January and June mm-hmm. from the state. There are times when that cash, you know, you hear we have $5 million in cash reserves. Yeah, you may have an average over a year's period, but in May, when you're a month away from being paid and you haven't been paid since January, those balances are much lower. And in June, of course, you have more because you've just got paid. So it's kind of an ebb and flow in the cash reserves. It's not gonna fund a major. Mm. You know, it'll. I think we always kept it where it was because if something, there was a hiccup with the state funds, mm-hmm. we wanted, the concern with cash reserves.
Well, they've been known to hang on to the cash.
Yes, they have.
They've done a much better job recently.
You want to make payroll. That's mm-hmm. that's the idea. You want to make sure the teacher's checks don't bounce.
Right.
That's kind of critical, and you want your staff to be assured that, you know, there's not going to be a hiccup in their paychecks. And I think that's kind of what the cash reserve is designed to do. As for capital projects, you know, it has to be a capital project fund cash mm-hmm. reserve. And I don't know that the cash reserves are, most of them are general fund.
John Pierce, if you needed to, could you do what East Allen is doing, which is primarily breaking the projects into smaller chunks where you don't have to go to the voter? You can go to through a petition process, as you did previously, mm-hmm. and perhaps get smaller things done that way, although I'm sure it would cost more in the long run.
Exactly. Like Center High School, doing just the repairs that we're talking about, we're not adding a square inch of space anywhere. Right. It's a $40 million project, mm-hmm. and we can't put that up to voters. And like John was saying earlier, if you do it piecemeal, it is going to cost a lot more mm-hmm. if you do it that way. But, yeah, could
be. And the soft costs are more.
And then you get the voters playing against each other, which is what the people in New Haven are worried about.
Exactly. Yeah, the nice thing about this is, I guess, is that it involves 36 schools and they're spread throughout the community.
You know, that's a big difference between four-way community school, though, in East Allen. East Allen is a fiefdom. Each school has its own district, and they fight for their own territory.
Well, in their own town.
We're a choice system where you pretty much can go anywhere. You know, when I had my school board district, I had people that lived in my district that went to every school across the district. Mm-hmm. So there's less of that mm-hmm. territorial thing in foreign community schools.
Yeah. Is there the sense of community within the schools that would make people willing to sacrifice, even if they don't have children in the schools? Or can you foster that between now and May 8th?
I think there is. I think, you know, some people are probably concerned about their own school. Why isn't ours on there? For example, I know people at Lane and Glenwood Park Elementary are concerned that they're not in the first offering here in the first phase of this, but we will get to them. And the only reason they're not in it, it's not because they're not needy schools, it's because we can't do all three of those on that same campus at one time. Yeah. It's going to be congested enough just doing Snyder, and they're all located in a very intense congested area there. So we don't sense that in our school district like you might elsewhere. It's not about basketball, but there's probably some out there.
I think there's a trust issue that you have to overcome. I think the way the last bond was marketed, things like the superintendent's comment that we're going to spend $400,000 for political cover for the board and the superintendent, which she put in writing. Things like, well, one of the things I've heard at least three times from three separate people is you guys have put or taken the public comment off of the board meetings. Little things chip away at public trust. And the Lane thing is interesting because we had phone calls. You're going to close Lane. You're not going to do any renovation at Lane or at Glenwood Park, and you know, why are you leaving us out? Well, it is exactly what John said. You can't do Snyder, you can't do Glenwood Park, and you can't do Lane. It would be complete chaos mm-hmm. in that entire feeder system, which sits in a three-block area. But you know, it's those kind of rumors where people. One of the things I think the district has really handled poorly is its social media policy, in which they're forcing teachers out, but even down to I've had a PTA parent tell me that she's been reprimanded for opposing the superintendent's raise mm-hmm. on Facebook. Well, you know, what a parent does on their own time on Facebook is none of the school's business. I think that's the kind of thing you really have to realize, that foreign community schools is a customer service business now.
I need to break in. We've only got about a minute left, and I want to make sure I get this question in, and John Pierce, if you could answer more short than I would have liked, but it's a tough
topic.
The common wage issue, which uh-huh. depending on how you go, advocates say could save up to 30%, which I'm sure is inflated, but you could save something perhaps. Mm-hmm. Will the board vote to go with the union scale, the non-union, or don't you honestly know at this point?
I don't honestly know. And what happens is the board appoints two members to that board, and there's others that vote, so it's really up to them to decide. And the common wage is supposed to be the most common wage for a particular trade.
Okay, well, I appreciate it. I'd love to talk about that more, but we are out of time. So, gentlemen, thank you. John Olinger, John Pierce, thank you. And thank you out there for joining us on the Fort Report. And you can watch the show as well at the News Sentinel webpage, www.news-sentinel.com. I'm Kevin Leininger. Thank you for joining us. Thank you.
Thank you. Yep. We off?
I believe we are. Mm-hmm.